Hello, I'm Kate Dundas from Sustainability Victoria. I'll be your host for our first episode of SV Forum Thinkers, where we share our thoughts on global climate and circular economy events and trends. This first episode is inspired by the upcoming World Circular Economy Forum, organised by the Finnish Innovation Fund Sitra, and taking place in Africa for the first time. The topics that are discussed at this forum represent some of the leading thinking on the circular economy and why it's such an important thing for us to embrace. We hope that this content will shed some light on these topics and what this might mean for Australia. In a moment, we'll be joined by Florian van den Corput from the SV Lab, who will take us through some of the key topics up for discussion at the World Circular Economy Forum. So stay tuned as we bring you our first episode of SV Forum Thinkers. Thanks for joining us, Florian. Now, first off, can you tell us what the World Circular Economy Forum is all about?
Sure. The World Circular Economy Forum is a landmark event of the year. It's being organised by Sitra, the Finnish Innovation Fund, and it brings together forward-looking thinkers, doers and game changers in the world of the circular economy. They'll talk about what some of the barriers are that countries face, some of the solutions that can be considered, and it's really talking about circular economy and putting it into the mainstream media. The really exciting thing about this year's event is that it's being held on the African continent for the first time in Kigali, Rwanda. And yeah, I'll be very excited to see what all the wonderful leading thinking will be about how we can assist and help Africa to transition to a circular economy in their future. And the cool thing is it's completely free. So if you're interested in joining us in this conversation, you can look for World Circular Economy Forum online and the website will pop up where you can register for free.
So Florian is here today to touch upon some of the topics that will be discussed in the World Circular Economy Forum and what they might mean for our transition to a circular economy here in Victoria. So Florian, let's start up with the question of the difference between the circular economy and a linear economy.
Yes, that's a great place to start. And this is really about how our economic system operates. So how we use resources, how we use materials, how we make products, and how does things flow through society. Now, traditionally in a linear economy, as the name implies, there's a clear beginning and an end to the resources that we use. So we extract them from the planet somehow, turn those into products, and we use those products, and then we dispose of them, generally into landfill at the moment. That might not sound like such a bad idea. I mean, there's plenty of materials out there at the moment you would consider, but there's actually some pretty dire issues that this system creates. It incentivizes short-term solutions. It often comes with financial exploitation, social inequity, the loss of biodiversity and the environmental degradation that creates is quite severe. So although we do have a lot of materials and there's a lot of resources in the ground, there is a limit to what we can extract. And the limit for some materials is actually much closer than you would think. Now, a circular economy, as opposed to a linear economy, is different in that we're trying to circulate products to keep materials in use for as long as possible. So that whole linear economy is about the take, make, waste mentality, and we're trying to turn that into a take, make, reuse slogan.
And why is it important that we do that now?
Well, the circular economy conversation really starts with climate change and the urgent need for us to take action on climate change now. If we are to reach net zero emissions by 2050, we need to reduce both the emissions that we create through energy use, so things like burning fossil fuels and keeping our society running, if you will, but also the emissions that we create by making things, by using materials. And in fact, it's estimated that about 70% of all emissions are eventually created through material handling and use. So a circular economy is quite important because it addresses how we use those materials, how we extract materials and eventually the emissions that we create through that. Now, the opportunity for Africa is very different from the opportunity that brings for Europe, which is very different from the opportunity for Australia. The circular economy is very dependent on the local context. If we look at the Australian context, for example, we see a place of wealth. We see a lot of relative prosperity here, which is great. It gives our citizens an opportunity to play on the global stage and have influence there. But at the same time, that comes with a lot of issues as well. Like, we consume a lot. We use a lot of things. Actually, we use too much.
We're sitting having this conversation in Melbourne, in Narm, on the lands of the Wurundjeri people. And Australia's traditional owners have the oldest and most sustainable culture in the world. Can you talk about the role of traditional owners in the transition to a circular economy?
Traditional owners have lived their lives and celebrated their culture in these lands for such an incredibly long time. And I think that Indigenous customs and traditions in Africa and across the world and in Australia as well, they often already are circular, and that's because they have a much closer understanding and connection with the natural environment and understand better what the limits are of the natural environment that supplies us with the things that we need to live and to thrive. I think it's important for us to consider what we can learn from them and also how they can lead us into a circular future. I think that this provides an incredible opportunity for us to strengthen our reconciliation efforts and to have a conversation about a shared vision about what that circular future looks like and give traditional owners a much stronger role to play in our society going forwards.
Now, we're sitting here in Melbourne in Australia. How are we tracking towards a circular economy?
Over the past decade, Australia has seen a surge of momentum for various sustainable development related themes. Circular economy is still quite a new concept in this country, but we're definitely seeing incredible investment taking place in this sector right now. Victoria has seen unprecedented investment in circular economy over the past few years. If we look at our Recycling Victoria policy, for example, that's investing in an incredible amount of money, time and effort to really create a foundation for a circular economy to take place here. It's investing in the infrastructure that we need as a basis for that. And that was followed by the Circular Economy Act of 2021, which really creates the legislative foundation to help support that transition to a circular economy. But also outside of government, we're seeing a lot of NGOs and private companies and private industry to embrace the circular economy as well. And I think that's because consumer sentiment is changing too. We see very big parties like Country Road Group, Kmart, Patagonia embrace circular initiatives and investment. But also smaller parties are coming up with some great initiatives like Returner, Nutri-V or ABCH, for example. Planet Ark and the Australian Circular Economy Hub are not-for-profits that are working to support the whole of the entire country, really, to support that transition to circularity. And they're also working on metrics, for example, so that we can properly measure our progress towards a circular economy. And just look at things like the Victorian Circular Economy Hub and the Victorian Circular Activator, which is an innovation hub that's been set up as a collaboration between SV, Swinburne and RMIT, for example. So yes, we've got a long way to go, but the foundation is being built as we speak and momentum is growing, which is exciting.
So the World Circular Economy Forum is likely to have governments represented from across the world. What role can governments play in the transition to a circular economy?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think that government policy has a strong impact on how our economy operates. Really, it's government policy that determines things like regulation, how and how much things are taxed, some of the industry that's incentivized here, and just generally the type of business that can take place here. And the circular economy cuts across all of these things. So we need to make sure that we don't consider these things as separate silos, but that we take a collaborative approach to address some of these things. Here in Victoria, we see collaboration taking place across the board between government, industry, and the community to make sure that all of these things are addressed holistically. On a national scale, I think that government policy needs to make sure that circular strategies are viable. And that goes far beyond just waste management. I don't think there's a point to recycling your resources if there's no use for them at the other end. So we need to work together across all levels of government to make sure that our products and materials are designed in a circular way, that they are used and disposed of in a circular way, and that they are managed and put back to use in a circular way as well.
The transition to a circular economy is going to require investment. Can you talk us through some of the challenges in attracting that investment?
We see financial decision makers consider transitioning to circular business models as risky. Yet the Ellen MacArthur Foundation has shown us with their research that circular business actually makes things less risky. They're showing that the more circular a business is, the less likely it is to default on debt, and also the higher their risk-adjusted stock performance becomes. So some of those things don't quite line up. And I think the main issue with that is that the linear way of doing things is being subsidized, which makes sense because our whole system is set up to be linear. So to overcome those challenges, what we really need to focus on is leveling that playing field and making sure that circular solutions are made viable, that we de-risk that business as much as possible.
Now, in the lead up to the World Circular Economy Forum, Citra has released a number of articles to set the scene. One of the quotes in the articles from Nelson Mandela says, "The youth of today are the leaders of tomorrow." Now, what role are young people in our transition to a circular economy?
They play an incredibly important role. I think that for Africa, it's interesting because they have the youngest population in the world. And really, that offers them an enormous resource to build the future with new ideas and with new perspectives. And I think that we must support young people here in Australia to do the same. And we must give them the tools so that they can build that circular future. There's quite a significant skills gap if we want to transition to a circular economy. And circularity is really not yet integrated that well into a lot of our university teaching programs, for example. And I don't think there's a point in creating a standalone circular economy course or master's program. That really needs to be integrated into all disciplines as a whole. Also, Sustainability Victoria has the Resource Smart Schools program. And as part of that, we have the After the Bell series, which aims to provide teachers and educators with the insights that they need to take action on these things even outside of the classroom. And I think that also outside of the education sector, private industry and industry players have a role to play as well in reskilling their workers. There's research that says in Europe, the estimate is that about 18 million workers will need to be reskilled in one form or another to be able to operate in this low carbon circular future. And a similar gap exists here in Australia.
Did you get taught about the circular economy when you were studying industrial design?
Mm.
You did?
It's an integral part of our curriculum. Yeah.
Yeah. I studied industrial design in the 90s, so I had a version of it, I think. Now, the World Circular Economy Forum will be discussing innovative business models. Can you talk a little bit about the potential for job creation in the transition to a circular economy?
Well, the potential for job creation is enormous, I think. When you consider the differences between a linear and a circular economy, you know, in a linear economy, we extract stuff from the planet, we turn that into products, and then we throw them away. You know, we throw them away in a landfill, and they're just sitting there. Whereas in a circular economy, if we want to keep materials in use, you know, we want to keep them circulating through the system. Well, we need skilled workers that support that. So think about repair facilities, reuse services, composting facilities, just having the service providers that enable all of these reverse logistics to take place. Like, we need people, skilled people that can do that type of work. And that's without even mentioning the additional infrastructure that we need, the skills that need to be taught, and all the business models that need to be adjusted to accommodate some of these circular solutions. As mentioned before, the economic potential of a circular economy in Australia is estimated at almost $2 trillion over the next 20 years. That's enormous. But at the same time, Circular Australia has also made estimates that that will result in about 150,000 ongoing jobs by 2025. So the potential is definitely there. And when we look at Australia in the global context, we have the third lowest rate of material productivity in the world, and we have the lowest manufacturing self-sufficiency in the OECD. So that might sound really negative, but I think it also highlights an equally positive opportunity for a circular economy to make work of that and to bring us up to where we want to be.
Thanks, Florian. The World Circular Economy Forum is going to include discussions on biodiversity loss. Now, can you talk a little bit about the impact of biodiversity loss?
Yeah, biodiversity plays an essential role in the numerous ecosystems that we find on Earth, of course. And these ecosystems are really the foundation of what us humans need to live, to thrive. However, biodiversity is being lost at an unprecedented rate. Some scientists believe that we are experiencing the sixth mass extinction event of species on the planet. We've lost 83% of mammals and about half of all plant species recently. And with Australia being a country that relies on the export of natural resources, like we export food and wine and cotton and wool, for example, that biodiversity loss puts our economy at risk. Aside from all the negative externalities that are happening to flora and fauna in this country.
Some very confronting statistics. Can you talk a little bit about what the transition to a circular economy can do to benefit our biodiversity?
Yeah, I think that a circular economy and biodiversity are quite closely linked, actually. We've got research by the International Resource Panel, which shows that about 90% of global biodiversity loss and water stress are caused by us extracting and processing natural resources. So a circular economy aims to improve how we extract and process natural resources. So the synergy is quite obvious there. There's quite a few sectors that require urgent action to address biodiversity loss, agriculture, the energy sector, fashion sector, and the built environment, for example. You can imagine that if we address our urban design principles and make denser cities and have more population density and build a city over a smaller footprint, we can actually have more space for nature within and outside of our urban areas and allow biodiversity to come back and to thrive. So you can see that a circular economy and biodiversity not only have a synergy, but that they actually strengthen efforts in both fields. So to me, that's a clear opportunity for us to address both of them at the same time. You're watering two plants with one hose.
Well, that's all we have time for today. Florian, thank you so much for joining us on SV Forum Thinkers. And I look forward to joining you as we tune in to the World Circular Economy Forum online. You can follow the conversation using the hashtag WCEF2022.